What up? What up? What up? What up? This morning, man. You know, I don't celebrate holidays, so y'all won't catch me a lot of times saying happy 4th or happy Christmas and shit. I don't celebrate them. I'm one of the people that really don't. But what up? How y'all this morning, man? I got a good show for y'all, a couple good things. And we're gonna get to it. So the first thing I want to bring y'all this morning in this morning convo to get to it is the history right now of I'm going to start in the middle with the history of the richest black girl during the 1913. It was something I came across, and her father got this money, so let's tap in and we can build about it. All right?
What up, African world? It's Home Team here, and welcome back to another video of African history, culture, and worldview. And by supporting this channel on Patreon, you're helping in the creation of these videos and supporting this content. If you'd like to show your support, you may do so by clicking the Patreon link in the description box below. Sarah Rector was often referred to as the richest colored girl in the world in the early 20th century. Born in 1902, she was a member of the Muskogee Creek Nation in Oklahoma. Following the Civil War, Rector's parents, who were formerly enslaved by Creek tribe members, were entitled to land allotments under the Dawes Allotment Act of 1887. As a result of this act, hundreds of black children, or the so-called Creek freedmen miners, were each granted 160 acres of land as Indian Territory integrated with Oklahoma Territory to form the state of Oklahoma in 1907. The parcel allotted to Sarah Rector was located in Glenpool, 60 miles from where she and her family lived. It was considered inferior soil, as better land was reserved for white settlers and members of the tribe. The land given to them required an annual tax of $30, which was becoming a burden for her father. He petitioned the court to sell the land, but the petition was denied. Sarah's father then leased the land to the Standard Oil Company, and in 1913, an independent oil driller, B.B. Jones, drilled a well on the property, which produced a gusher that began to bring in 2,500 barrels of oil a day. Sarah began to receive a daily income of $300 from this strike, which equates to about $7,000 a day today.
Brandon, what up?
Over time, her popularity began to bloom as her wealth increased. Sarah received numerous requests for loans, money gifts, and even marriage proposals from four Germans, even though she was just 12 years old.
She was 12, and the Germans and other people, other nationalities, were trying to marry her to take her money from her, which is crazy. So if you want to know what happened, it was a lot of wealth. And then we got to realize, like I told y'all, in the 1800s to the 1920s, there were so many black millionaires that don't make any sense. There's clearly a miss, a whole bunch of history missing.
At the time, a law required Native Americans, black adults, and children who are citizens of Indian Territory with significant property and money to be assigned a well-respected white guardian. As a result, Sarah's guardianship switched from her parents to a white man named T.J. Porter. Concerned with her well-being and her white financial guardian, early NAACP leaders fought to protect Sarah and her fortune, as these so-called white guardians were nefarious in their dealings with assigned black subordinates. In 1914, the Chicago Defender published an article claiming that her estate was being mismanaged by grafters and her so-called ignorant parents, and that she was uneducated, dressed in rags, and that she lived in an unsanitary shanty environment. National African American leaders such as Booker T. Washington and W.E.B. Du Bois became increasingly concerned about her welfare. Of course, none of the allegations were true, as Sarah and her siblings went to school in Taft, an all-black town, and they lived in a modern five-room cottage, and they owned an automobile. That same year, Sarah enrolled in the Children's House, a boarding school for teenagers at the Tuskegee Institute in Alabama. Everything changed for Sarah, even her race, apparently, as her...
Is this brown-skinned color girl made white? You know, I do the commercial. It's deep. If you look at it on the poster board, let's pause. It says, brown-skinned color girl made white. Oklahoma, which passed a law declaring all Indians white, is about to make the African-American young lady with the same hue on account of her millions. She will be given special privileges. So, as you see, if you think that this whole shit about the status of white is bullshit, if you look back at 1913, this is brown-skinned color, right? And that's like saying browns. All this is a color of law, right? And it says girl made white. That's her status. Let me show you. Girl made white. Brown skin, girl made white. So that means in Oklahoma, which passed a law declaring all Indians white. So what it did was basically all they did was give the Indians their status back. Just like how they gave the Hispanics their status back a couple years ago. So that's just a side note.
Declare Sarah to be a white person so that she would be allowed to travel in first class accommodations on the railroad. By age 18, Sarah was estimated to be worth $1 million, which equates to about $11 million today. She owned stocks and bonds, a boarding house, a bakery and restaurant in Muskegee, Oklahoma, and 2,000 acres of land. She eventually left Tuskegee with her family and moved to Kansas City, Missouri, where she bought a very elaborate home that still stands today, known as the Rector House. In 1922, she married Kenneth Campbell, the second African-American to own an auto dealership. And together, they became African-American royalty. The couple had three sons, drove expensive cars, and entertained elites like Joe Louis, Duke Ellington, and Count Basie at their expensive home. Sarah lived a comfortable life and enjoyed her wealth. She dressed really well and made sure to get the finest clothing. One noteworthy deed of hers is instructing her driver to drive the kids in the neighborhood to school. Unfortunately, this all came to an end as Sarah lost a lot of her wealth during the Great Depression, as did many Americans in general. Upon her death, at the age of 65, she only managed to hold on to some working oil wells and real estate holdings. Well, I'm all out, guys. If you like these videos and want to help out in its continued production, please consider supporting the home team on patreon.com. The link is in the description box below. Know thyself. Remember your ancestors.
So it said historically, if we listen to what they said at the end, they said that she, basically the Great Depression made them broke. One of these days this week, I'm going to show y'all this shit I seen on Netflix about the gold and how they took the gold, like the truth in the Great Depression. It was more of a lie. They just wanted to take all of the gold from the public. And so during that time, during the Great Depression, it was another way to cripple the dark skin, the so-called black man in America from his wealth. You know what I mean? Let's go to the next one. Be a lot of history today. But this one is called History of a Black Man and what he was doing all over the planet at the time, or what was going on. Of course, they're going to have commercials, so give me a second. But how y'all feeling this morning? What up, cuzzo? But this is the history of the black man that's coming up next that we're going to talk about and just show, like, the problems that they saw. Go back a little bit. Let's get it.
Black men in African history. Now, this video is not going to be exclusively about history, but it's also going to be a philosophical review of African men and their descendants. So like as women, black men are also very diverse. We can pretty much characterize black men into three major categories based on major language phylum. You have the Niger-Congo man, which is the black man's primary and most dominant language group. Then you have the Nilo-Saharan and the Afrasan black man. Black men's major civilization can be broken up by region. In West Africa, it was Ouagadou, Mali, and Songhai. In Central and Southern Africa, it was Kanem, Congo, in Great Zimbabwe. And in Eastern Africa, he had Meroe, Egypt, and Aksum. These classical civilizations of Africa exemplify in part who the black man is and gives us clues concerning his nature. Upon studying these civilizations, you'll realize how different and diverse they all are, but more importantly, how his tremendous diversity impacted his story. You see, like all men, black men were never unified under any racial identity, but by ethnic or language group. But because the diversity of black men was so much more significant in size, this became in many ways his burden. The inherent beauty of black men and his greatness is his diversity, as it greatly contributed to the entire genetic fabric of our planet, literally building what we know today as a human race. But this greatness was also his weakness because, due to the gravity of his diversity, he was never able to consistently conquer himself. Advancing a unified social or cultural political meaning amongst his brothers. Our goal today is to try and understand black men and their history. So what was the first black man like? What kind of culture did he develop? What were some of his first thoughts and ideas? Well, the very first significant cultural trait we see black men create is mummification. A culture that the world would marvel at thousands of years later. The first sign of complete mummification was called the Black Mummy, found in southern Libya. Scholars proclaim the boy was of sub-Saharan origin. You see, mummification is important into our understanding of the black man's first thoughts and ideas.
Mummification also was important because, if you want me to be honest with you, something they don't say is that apparently the ancients had an idea when, because you have to think about the technology they had. I don't know if they understood cloning completely, but I'm pretty sure they had an idea of cloning or something like it. So even if they didn't have the technology, to preserve skin and tissue would be to preserve the DNA so that they could be cloned, in my opinion, in the future, in case technology ever caught up, because they wanted to live forever.
Burying your dead in such a manner hints to the idea that black men knew there was something special about the human body and that somehow its preservation meant something. Later, he continued to advance and evolve in his thinking, and his process of mummification became intrinsically tied to how he viewed the world around him. This, in essence, became a religion. Thus, it was black men who founded the world's most significant religious thought. Black men were the first men to consume and digest the idea of God, at times even elevating himself, and especially his women, to the level of a deity. His religion is what continued to drive his thinking and even advance him into a civilized human being as religion demanded it. He began creating structures like at Napta Playa in the Nubian desert, which was an astronomical observance, and according to some scholars, began one of the first cultures of sculpture development. According to some scholars, the man who sparked this culture in Africa seems to have been the Nilo-Saharan black man arising from sub-Saharan Africa. As this Nilo-Saharan man moved further north, his experience changed slightly, and he began to develop what would later be adored by humanity. Preserving the human anatomy in stone and even measuring our place in the universe through astronomical observance, expressing our importance as humans. Once you think highly of yourself and a human body, you must then create institutions to preserve and protect it. And it was this man that is believed to have founded the first significant civilization in Africa, Ta Seti. This Nilo-Saharan black man is important to our understanding of the black man's first thought. And once we understand it, we realize he sparked what would later become a religion in African high societies. Now, the Niger-Congo black man seems to have been very different from his brothers. It was the Niger-Congo man that seems to have developed the most significant conquering spirit on the continent. As he apparently saw the need to expand his influence, he was the first to do this and was immensely successful at it, nearly taking the whole continent during the Bantu expansion. There is no doubt the Niger-Congo black man is the most dominant presence on the continent. In fact, even though there is no direct evidence of this, his expansion might be the very reason why we see Nilo-Saharan man further north. Given all of this, it would seem as though the Niger-Congo man helped to maintain and promote the matrilineal system of the entire continent, a system that his brothers seemed to embrace. He also seemed to be the first to train his brain with mathematics with the presence of the Ashango bone. Mathematics, of course, being one of the bedrock.
And that tool, in case y'all don't know, that's a tool. It's actually a ruler. They have a couple of those that's super old, super, super old. It says 20,000 years ago. So if y'all want to argue where a lot of people say, like, the black man, like, is only 8,000, the Bible only 6,000 years old, this outdates that or all the religious books. But this instrument, actually, if you study Africa, is actually a ruler. It's the cubic meter that everybody copied.
Of civilization. The ideas of the Nilo-Saharan black man seems to have been borrowed and further
Jesus, let's stop. But that's probably more so what Jesus looked like. You know what I'm saying? Hair like lamb's wool, because lamb's hair is very beautiful. It's not a nappy.
Developed by the Afrasan black man. This Afrasan man seems to have been unique, as it was him that popularized the idea that the black man himself was God. He also popularized and improved upon the culture of his brother, the Nilo-Saharan, with writing, culture, and statehood. The Afrasan black man and his geographical proximity.
What y'all gonna do if I got this hair doing my video in like 2 years? Y'all gonna still rock with me?
Proximity to the rest of the world assigned him with being the carrier of African culture and religion, exposing and introducing it to the rest of the world. Historically, it was his civilization that became the most recognizable and relatable to the rest of the world. So let's look at some black men in African history that exemplify the character of the Niger-Congo, the Nilo-Saharan, and the Afrasan. Sanjata Keita and Manza Sakura of the Mali Empire are two examples of black men coming from humble beginnings, beating the odds and rising.
And Khalil, don't laugh, because I had braids a couple years ago for the first time. I got girl hair when this shit braided, so that's what it probably would look like, too.
And to the top, Sanjata was reported to be crippled and despised in Mali, but he defeated Sumunguru Kante, becoming the founder of the greatest empire in West African history. Manza Sakura was literally a slave, starting all the way at the bottom and becoming the king of Mali. Shaka Zulu also speaks to the Niger-Congo experience. He literally influenced and changed the culture of an entire region, becoming the driver of a new culture, literally setting trends and changing the African space that he was in. The descendants of these Niger-Congo black men exemplify all these characteristics today. As black men in the New World suffered and survived the most gruesome act in human history, at times even gaining positions of power. But more importantly, he became the driver of culture in North and South America, setting trends that other groups of people began to mimic and even embrace. It's clear that the descendants of the Niger-Congo black man has inherited his characteristics. Even when he was robbed of his culture and identity, literally starting from the bottom, he began to recreate himself and start a new culture that still became irresistible to the rest of the world. King Narmer in many ways symbolizes the Afrasan black man. King Narmer was the first black man to create an empire on the continent.
Look at this hieroglyph for a second. I want to show y'all something. Just to show you why, when you read books, that you got to use your own eyes. So in these pictures in school, they would have told us, they said, okay, you see King Narmer, right? And then they would have told you he's enslaving another African. But if you look at the features on this man, he is, it is another one of us. But if you look at the way that he's dressed and the way that these are somebody from his village, they're different. They're different civilizations. They're not actually like he just torturing somebody. He know this is somebody. This is more like, I guarantee you, this is more of a Hitchhike or Asian black man that they at war with. Because Egypt had a lot of wars and Nubia had a lot of wars with each other, but they had more wars against people coming in. And at the top, you know what I'm saying? You see the hawk. Because you see the hawk in our culture is respected. It has an, it, the way it lives is honorable. Unlike the bald eagle that is more of a scavenger. You know what I'm saying? And that's what the Europeans used as their logo, which was a scavenger, because it would kill anything.
Even though it wasn't the first civilization, Egypt became the first significant empire in all of African history. An empire that led to great things. The Afrosan man's geographical presence along the coastal regions of Africa is significant. He was the first to introduce the black man's culture and ideas to the rest of the world. Ideas and culture that became very influential outside of Africa.
He got a fez on, y'all. If you look at his head, he got a red, he got a hat on, a crown like a fez.
And he is believed to be the first to branch outside the continent, hence the name Afrosan or Afro Asiatic. Then we have the Nilo-Saharan. He did something that has never been done on planet Earth. What he and his predecessors did gives us valuable insight into understanding the natural core of black men, the color of his soul, which continues to paint all black men today. What he did in ancient times is the closest thing we have to understanding who black men are. The Niger-Congo and the Afrosan black man did some things that can be seen throughout all men on the planet. But the Nilo-Saharan black man makes the distinction of all black men really clear.
Right,
King Pi, the Kushite, went up into Egypt and conquered it, not to destroy it, but to revitalize and restore Nile Valley culture. The Kushites literally forgave their enemies and rebuilt the cultural and religious infrastructure of the Nile Valley, returning it to its African context. Never in the history of the world has any man conquered a region for the sole purpose of restoring their enemies' culture and worldview. Granted, it was a culture that the Nilo-Saharan Kushites believe belonged to them. But this very idea of forgiveness and restoration is unique. This one event exposes us to the core of all black men, how he views himself and the world around him. Despite the vast diversity of all these black men, the Niger-Congo, Nilo-Saharan, and Afrosan black men, there seems to be one characteristic that unifies them, or at least dominates their nature, their core. It stems from a subconscious belief seemingly inherent to all black men, the belief that he is morally superior, or in other words, morally responsible for mankind, as if he'd been assigned by nature itself. The same way the Kushites believed the Egyptian culture ultimately belonged to them, thus making them morally responsible for its corruption. So too does the black man subconsciously believe that he is the first man, creating the first culture and the first civilization. Thus, according to him, he is burdened with supervising the moral compass of mankind. Why? Because in his eyes, nature itself assigned it to him. This belief, ironically, causes a very peculiar disposition amongst black men, which we'll call moral complacency. A disposition in which he very rarely fights against. I'll explain a little later. So how does this moral complacency tangibly play itself out? Well, the Niger-Congo, Nilo-Saharan, and Afrosan never expanded outside the continent with the sole purpose of gaining resources and or wealth. The acquisition of land for black men had very little, if anything at all, to do with his feeling of worth or superiority. So ultimately, what is moral complacency, and how does it fit in with the story of black men? As black men left his home in Africa, he planted his seed across the entire planet. Every continent we look, we see pieces of his presence. But something happened that black men did not expect. He began to change due to his environment. In many ways, black men was shaping nature around him, and nature was loyal to him. But little did he know that nature was also shaping him. Thus, as time passed, the nature of his genetic, cultural, and spiritual seed began to be very different from what he remembers. This is the origin of his fear, but we'll get to that later. Black men descend from a continent with plenty of land and resources, so there never really seemed to develop a sense of urgency to survive and at times even compete. The key word here being urgency. Like mentioned before, black men were no strangers to diversity and language barriers amongst himself. But unfortunately, because of this, he assumed every foreign man he encountered had a similar nature to his own. One of his ills is his struggle to understand the motives behind other men that seek to destroy him, as he seems to have developed no need to genetically survive, as his genes and his subconscious opinion have been distributed throughout the entire earth long ago. And he also never developed an incessant need to feel superior to others, perhaps to his fault in a cosmic sort of way. In all men, he sees a sort of molecular piece of himself. This phenomenon, which I call moral complacency, seems to be unique to black men. Because of this, black men, especially today, largely succeed only as an individual. His greatness is seldom used to advance his own nation. Why? Yeah, what up? Mostly internal, but also some external factors apply.
Good morning.
But ultimately, because on a primordial level, he believes the world is his nation, as it originally belonged to him. His moral superiority has usually harmed him. That is his blessing and his curse, and though it provides him at times with cognitive dissonance, oddly enough, that is the only way he learned to be human. In essence, the only way he truly understands being human, and he feels burdened to teach mankind how to be like what he remembers, what he understands as human. The black man's greatest fear, no matter how irrational, is not that he will be annihilated, because to him that is simply impossible. The black man's greatest fear is coming to terms with the idea that the earth no longer belongs to him, that the earth abandoned its original creation, that he will not be the source of the earth's future evolution, that he will not be the source and the origin of humanity's next phase, that his idea of human is not what nature assigned it to be. This is why he remains morally complacent even when faced with the destruction of his own nation, because his moral complacency allows him to infiltrate himself in other nations, being the driver of its culture, becoming the ghostwriter for the social cultural evolution of our planet. This is why he has no issue being successful as an individual in a society he did not create.
Boom. All these right here are pictures of the Moors when they were selling white women. So when I was telling you what we call European women, in these old ancient pictures, the first slavery was done by black men who sold white women as prostitutes and slaves. So when we heard in the 1860s and the early 1900s, when white men was like, we're gonna fill the rivers up with black men bodies to secure the white woman, is because the truth is the white women are afraid that the black man is gonna get power and sell her again. So it's a lot of, it's a bitter truth that nobody talks about in history. But if you look at all the pictures of a lot of them, they were selling them. That's why the women were on the floor naked. They were slaves.
Because in that, in his primal opinion, the earth will continue to belong to him. And he can continue to define what a human is. You see, back then, as he planted his seed across a planet in the beginning, he only saw himself and one version of humanity. But of course, this has changed. This is not the humanity he has come to know and understand. Thus, in his moral superiority, he will do anything to remain the driver of what he feels humanity is, cultivating its culture and its worldview, even at the expense of his own nation. However, the question is his commitment to moral complacency worth it? In other words, are his fears of an unfamiliar humanity worth his nation? This is a question that black men are beginning to ask himself right now in the 21st century. What is the value of my moral superiority, and will nature continue to honor it? And when we, as black men, finally answer this question, whatever the answer may be, it will greatly determine the social, political, and spiritual tone for the entire planet for the next 500 years. Why? Well, because black men have always been the spark of humanity's cultural and spiritual significance. He founded the first human moral codes. Let's really think about the subconscious of black men. Who was the...
Let me tell you why I understand this guy and his whole approach philosophically, because it's a philosophical joint. The morals, like the black man and his morals, the word more and the word moral, just like the word love, you know what I'm saying, in Spanish, you know what I'm saying? It's all in that same word. So the word itself expresses a nature. So when he said the black man had a moral, these morals, these things that you feel like that all human beings should have, like living in peace, you know, honor, respect, discipline. All of these things is the demise of the black man. You know what I'm saying? Because against the other men of the planet, that comes last, and other things come first that allowed him to be in power today.
The first celebrated and well-known black man in African history. His name was Asar. And what did Asar concern himself with in life? The first thing that Asar did was teach others how to be human, how to be morally upright, and how to build civilization. This was the first championed image of a man that black men developed for himself. The first thought of black men, his first celebrated figure in his mind, advanced characteristics of teaching men how to be human, teaching them a morally proper worldview. And what happened to Asar? He was killed and dismembered, and later his wife brought his pieces together and wrapped it up in the first ever mummification process. For the black man, mummification exemplifies the importance of the human body, but more importantly, what the human body means and represents. The first man was morally upright, teaching the world the idea of what a man is and what a human is. And it was him who was the first to be mummified or preserved. To the black man, preserving this ideal man or ideal human is of utmost importance to him. Even though black men have been dehumanized and despised by all groups of non-Africans, ironically, he alone invented the human institutions that became the only thing separating man from beast. Art, culture, and civilization. This tradition is continued amongst his sons. Non-Africans continue to obsess and absorb and even mimic the black man's art and culture, but despise its creator. But strangely enough, that's not even the black man's burden. The black man's burden is not that he is oppressed and forgotten. His burden is being the moral, cultural, and spiritual compass of the human spirit. His curse is that he constantly seeks validation from which he deems the first reflection of his creator, nature, which in his subconscious mind may or may not be loyal to him anymore. Despite his extraordinary resilience to the most gruesome act in human history, his survival and his patience with humanity is unrivaled. One of his greatest attributes, which in many ways became a driver for his survival, is his creativity. Black men have continually done things that has not been done by any man on the planet. It's a rather impressive accomplishment. As most men on the planet needed the sword to do so, black men has done it with his mind. Well, what is it? It's his culture. The culture of black men is the only thing that has genuinely conquered the world. And that has become his greatest weapon for preserving his idea of human. Well, guys, I'm all out. I want to dedicate more time and attention to my videos, so I'm making the transition over to Patreon. All my videos are going
tapping out on, bro, because my internet being a little crazy. But the name of this, if y'all want to go back and check it, is History of Black Men. You know what I mean? They got a couple more in there if y'all want to check them out.
Knowledge of African history who makes the same argument. What I'm saying is someone who's telling you, well, then you're negating your being, is negating yourself. That's self-hatred. And then I say, well, wait a minute. I don't hate the fact that I'm descendant of the ancient Kemites. I'm not hating the fact that my ancestry is connected to the people within the Moorish Empire or ancient Carthage or the peoples of Mali or the ancient Congo or Angola. I said, where do you want to go? The Knok culture? I mean, come on, right? I know who, I can tell you about Europeans worshiping Africans. I used to tell my students when I first started teaching, they would make fun of some students who were darker in hue. And I used to tell my students, I wish I was that complexion. And the students look at me going, wait a minute, why would you want to look like this person who's so black, so dark? And I said, because I know who they are, because I know their value. The problem is you don't. And they're looking to me as a young teacher and going, well, wait a minute now, this young teacher, why would he want to affirm that, right? So clearly my aversion was not to saying I'm of African ancestry or that I have an aversion to being dark in complexion. My aversion is to the word black. But there was a long period of time when they couldn't become citizens because of a fear of China's presence. In fact, part of what people talk about, the yellow peril, that was a term from those days. The yellow peril was what they said. They were afraid the Chinese were too foreign to be absorbed into U.S. culture, Americana. But what it was straight up racism against this Asian community, the Chinese. But here's the key. Even though the mainstream media was often calling them the yellow peril, they didn't continue to call themselves yellows. So I'm trying to figure out why folks are still, you know, trying to hold on to black. Here's my guess. The people very often who will tell you you're the one, because I've heard the same thing, and they come after me too at times saying based on my complexion too, because make an assumption. And I say, look, I just told you I've dedicated my entire professional life to uncovering and to teaching the legacy of African people, our contributions to the world, right? I dedicated my, I was disciplined and dedicated enough to make that my mission. As the French might say, my raison d'être, my reason for being, or d'être, reason for being. But this idea of saying, you're doing that because you're self-hating, I turn it around and say, I think you don't want to call yourself African because you're not comfortable with being of African ancestry. You somehow think black gives you an out. When you're talking about the best of African cultures, respect for the elders, recognizing the interdependence and interconnection of all things, which means you have a greater respect for nature.
That's the key.
Or nature. It means that you clearly know that I'm important because we are important. The communalistic view versus the individualistic view. The desire to remain in harmony with nature, right? Those are just a few examples of what we would say were part of a traditional African worldview. The extended family versus the nuclear family construct. That's why customarily, how long we've been calling each other brothers and sisters, right? This idea of recognizing, even when I went to visit family back home in Bermuda for the first time when I was a child, everybody calls everybody cousin. So they're like, what's up, cousin? And I was like, cousin, right? Some people joke and say, well, it's because the country is so small, everybody is a cousin, because everybody's so related. But the other piece is, it has to do with our particular value system, our axiology, that you are an extension of me. So I'm trying to do what I can to make it in the world, but without causing you much or any harm if possible. And I certainly see your value. I'm not going to devalue you because you look like me. What am I saying about myself?
Hey, two different people. It said, ways praise Africans, but don't like the African-American. Because, and do you want me to be clear? This is a Grand Sheik in Chicago, so he's, like I always say, he's talking in adept. And when you talk to the people, he can't talk in what he understands. He got to talk in a language that the other people understand. So he said, we praise the African, but don't like to praise the African-American, right? Because the African-American, only thing the African-American knows of itself is that they were slaves, and that they was being whipped, and they was being hung. And that they was, and the females were being raped and being taken advantage of and working with massa. If you look at history, according to psychology, depending on what a person knows about their past, depends on how far they go in their future. So if the average black person, and I use the word black because people understand, the average black person in America in the hood don't know much history. So that's why they're living in a certain state of mind, feeling like, yo, this is the best that I could do is get this money to get out of here in a lot of ways, because they had no concept. It's not like we grew up in the hood and they was teaching us these things that gave us this self-worth. They was indoctrinating us with inferiority with the school books. And we praise the African because the average person, and I get your question, it's a great question. I think the average person praised the African, the average African-American, so-called black man in America, and black woman praises Africa because that's the only thing, like, you know, school made it cool for you to see Egypt and all of these statues because they was cool with you not understanding that the black man on another continent was that nigga. And they was cool with you thinking that, you know what I mean? So in school, you got to remember, Egypt was one of the few things that was so beautiful. They was amazed by it, that they gave us certain pieces. So we easily to relate back to the beautiful areas of that, you know what I'm saying? And yeah, you're right. He says, blacks are a secret word for them to know that you don't know who you are. Right. African-American has no rights. Plus, it's not a nationality. Like I always tell people, if a so-called African, because Africans don't live in Africa either. That's what I'll be trying to get y'all to see. I personally think that that's more like a American-made construct. Because if you talk to them, they're going to tell you where they came from. Gambia, Nubia, Mali. You know what I'm saying? They don't live in Africa. They don't say I'm a Mali African or a Nubian African. So when we say African-American, we're ignorant because anybody outside of America, any intellect outside of our small way of thinking who asks you, so what are you? And you be like, I'm African-American. They're going to look at you like you crazy because you just named two different continents. And your nationality, technically, when they ask you who you are, is supposed to identify your bloodline and what continent your ancestors came from. When we say, what are you? You say, we black? That's like, what? And that, what are you? I'm African American. That's even worse. Because now you saying you come from Africa and America. But that's not a proper identification. You know what I'm saying? Your blood, like, you know, when they say the Chinese, that's not their real name. You know what I'm saying? That's the name that was given to them after basically the conquering of China. You know what I'm saying? But the Mandarin people are the name of the Chinese people. But if they go around and they say, you know, when they say that they're Chinese, they lose their birthright too. So like, just like how black, how Brandon said black is a secret word for they know that you don't know who you are, so it's Chinese for the Chinese people. You know what I'm saying? No nationality, you will be lost. You know what I'm saying? But you, it's letting you know, like when people say they're Moor, the Moor means Mobite. Mobite own the estate of the Americas. You know what I'm saying? North, South, Central, Amexum. You know what I'm saying? You can't be, say, right, you can't come from two continents. You have to identify with one. So that's why, legally, you know what I'm saying? That's what B is saying. But the reason why black people look back to Africa so much and respect the African, but don't respect the African-American, because you ain't going to find much about the African-American. The history of the African-American started when they freed the slaves, to be clear. If you want to know your history of African-American, that whole legacy started after slavery. You know what I'm saying? That's how it don't go back far at all. Go back to, what, 1800s, early 1800s, shit like that? That's where the history of the African-American starts. Or the so-called African-American. Because to be quite frank, they'll say, no, the terminology came in the early 1900s. You know what I'm saying? You say, I just said that for another word for black, right? No, we get it. But it's just the fact, that's why everybody worshiping Africa is so crazy. It's not because the fact of the matter that people are so wrong, but that's all they have to connect to. They don't know, people don't know that the oldest mounds, which are pyramids in America, you know what I'm saying? People don't know that the mound builders who created the building of the pyramids came from like the Wichita area in New Orleans. They just don't know. It'd be different if they told you that Nefertiti was really from down the Mississippi, but they're not going to tell you that because it's going to connect you back to making you feel great, because you can't teach a whole race of people they inferior their whole life. If you educate them about how kings and queens they were, it's to keep you up, to keep you down. And if you feel negatively about yourself, then you ain't going to do much.
This Japanese man came in, he worked with him in the, for...
You said I referred to myself as black. My question was in reference to the love we give African people from continent Africa is not reciprocated. Why? What do you mean, like they don't give it back to us? Because that's what you mean when you say people from the continent of Africa is not reciprocated. So you're saying like, why don't they give that love back, or why don't they admire us? I mean, it's hard to admire conquered people. You know what I'm saying? It was on earth. There was a lot of conquered people, you know what I'm saying? But the American, so-called American black man, is weird how they don't understand how the black man didn't rebel and fight for his freedom when other areas did. Well, as they say, it's not that we didn't, but it had to be. It was some deep shit going on. And that's why I always say that it has to be true that the black man and the black woman did not run in slavery, because the black man and black woman also knew that the black man and the black woman were slavers. So it was nowhere to run. You know what I'm saying? So let's get back to it.
The Metropolitan Transit Authority, he used to do carpentry, repairing the trains, the subways. And this man would basically keep to himself. He would just come in and bring his lunch, and he would sit down and eat. And, you know, he might nod or something to people, but he kept to himself. And this continued for some time. And then one day, my uncle, who was a member...
The Africans do know that we're not from there. You know what I'm saying? And that I had mentioned this before. I've been mentioning this. They know, like, we got to understand that Pangea, the idea of Pangea was the world was one. But when the great earthquakes and everything happened and through the years where everything split, you don't think it was nobody already living on the continent of America, what we call America, or on that landmass that broke off, that big landmass, there was people already living there. If it was that one time, it was always connected. When it split, the people were already there. So that land, people that lived on that land always lived on that land. So the Africans know when they come here that we're not from Africa. That's the difference. I don't think we ever asked the Africans, how many of us really literally go to Africa from other countries? And first of all, they don't respect us because we don't respect ourselves on average. And then how many of us got the common sense to sit down and ask them questions? Because see, Americans, you know, the Africans tell me this. American blacks are some ignorant motherfuckers. This is what the Africans tell me. And they talk to me because my cheekbones and I look like African, I believe. But I agree with them that the American black man doesn't ask the African man or woman what they know. Because the American black man and American black woman already think they know it all. This is facts. The black man and the black woman doesn't care today on average about who he or she was. Because we go to school and we're looking at all these books, but we don't even ever think to go talk to the Africans. I talk to the Africans and they would tell you clearly, they know that your ancestors did not come from Africa. Meaning that, yes, some of the immigration, I mean, when they traveled, like way before slavery, they came over here. But by then they had already established what was theirs and what was rightfully not. So that's why during this whole Pangea, it says people have to realize that all of the continents were once connected to Pangea, right? So, I mean, it's the fact that it's all about understanding. Like, I'm just saying, how many people go to Africans and ask them, where did you grow up? Okay, well, what do you know about slavery in America? And what do you know about slavery in Africa? And you're going to get a completely different story. I met some Africans that don't know anything about this so-called slave trade. Not to the Americas. Because the triangle slave trade was from Africa to Europe to South America. That's the triangle. I don't understand where else the triangle going to come from. Because they made it clear that Christopher Columbus and most of them never even made it to America. So that's why South America got the second highest population of Africans on the planet. Other than Africa. South America. Not America. So that's one of the things is that I noticed that a long time ago. They always tell me from different, I talk to people from Gambia, from Mali, from, you know what I'm saying, Nigeria. And they always tell me, like, you know, black people are very, very arrogant in America. And not to mention that they haven't really accomplished shit in the last couple hundred years, period. Because let's be quite frank, the inventions during slavery, according to the people that enslaved them, it was the first time they seen them projects. But like a lot of the people, we respect the frauds. That created the hot comb, Madam C.J. Walker. They had hot combs drawn on the wall in Nefertiti's tomb like 8,000 years ago. But she was wealthy and she got a chance to travel and go to Africa. See, they don't put that in there. So she got a chance to see this shit. She had money. So she was able to, when everybody else was being oppressed, she was able to see it. But these inventions already were invented. You know, you got to think literally. Nobody thinks about it. How do a people born ignorant that can't read or write or do math create the cotton gin and these trucks that take mathematics and write? That mean that they had to be kidnapping motherfuckers who was free already, that already understood education and already was inventors and already like that. Because you can't not, you know what I mean? They can't just be ignorant like they claim to be. You know what I mean? But that's just being real. It's like it's a conversation that can go on forever about this conversation. We just got to understand it's all about how we see the world in a proper perspective. Understanding that every nation on the planet comes with a flag and a place, meaning that the African can't save the American black man. The American black man, which means man and woman, man is plural. The American black man has to be willing to free himself. Especially since the American black man was really the culture changer, the trendsetter, right? Because the founders of civilizations and all that, like, you know, they say the homeland. But when it comes down to civilization, how they go about structure, street lighting, that's more shit. That's the Moors. See, there's different forms. You got the so-called Egyptians, which that wasn't their names, you know what I'm saying? They call the Kushites. Then they got all of these other areas around Africa and all these different tribes of people. And then when you're dealing with history, the first thing you got to recognize is that some of these people are related. Like two generations ago, that king left and went to South America or went to what we call Europe and started a faction there. So that's why it says they took everything we knew and killed us off. That's why we didn't know about it. That's why the point of the matter, all of the original people, most of them are dead. All of like the real, like the pure blooded so-called dark-skinned man and woman, most of them are dead. There's not too many of them really walking around the planet. that we are, everybody on the planet on average is really a somewhat mixture of that man. That man they exterminated a long time ago. They went out their way to exterminate that man off the planet. So even when you talk about the Moors, they say, you know, in the laws with aboriginals, ab being like albino, AB, mixture of the African and the albino blood. That's why we call the copper people of America. You know what I'm saying? If you look at a lot of these things, you can see it for yourself. The problem is, us as people have been taught and trained to think one thing. We think that just because we don't look at history for what it is. Like, I talked to a lot of people that be like, hey, man, the Moors is traitors. Hey, man, everybody in the fucking planet has something to do with slavery. And every race enslaved itself. But what you don't think about when you talking shit is that, first of all, it's a lack of respect for yourself, because every culture got good and bad. So the fact that when black people be like, I don't want to talk about the Moors because they did this. Well, name a culture in fucking history who did not do some foul shit. You want to talk about the European? Do the Europeans talk shit about their own? Not really. Do the Italian, they did some foul shit? Do they care? They don't know. But we quick to say, oh, I want to beat them. But you ain't going to find no people on the planet that did all good. It's the process of man. So a lot of people say, yo, the Moors enslaved the Africans. Listen, if you study, you'll realize that the Moors went into the Congo and was telling them, like, listen, we have been, you guys are still in the woods, butt naked with sticks, when we have been in civilization for thousands of years. We keep coming back giving for technology, and you keep sending us off, and y'all not progressing, y'all not advancing. So they thought, in my opinion, that they didn't want to progress. And it was tribes in the bush that was giving them a bad name for what was going on in the world, like the colonizers that was coming in and taking advantage, when they saying, like, listen, if y'all in the bush and living this simplistic lifestyle, then that's where they come and they're being able to pass these edicts all over the world to say that we savages. But you also got to remember the word Moor is used on every continent. What you cannot prove is that you cannot prove that this guy they called the Moor and this guy and this woman that they call Moors, you can't prove that they even fucking knew each other. And that's what I'm be trying to tell people, because black people know so fucking much. And that be the problem with going places. I've gotten in more arguments with black people than anybody else. I have a conversation, it'd be 60 people in a room, 40 black. I talk this shit, every other nationality in the fucking room know what I'm talking about, and they respect it, and they honor black man in his position. But not black man and black woman, because they think that this reality and civilization that they live in that ain't shit today means something. Or if you ain't got a job, you ain't shit. And the way a real nigga like me look at it, if you got a job, you're a fucking slave. But you don't want to hear our opinion. That's what I be saying. Yeah, you got to take care of your kids, but you too, the average man and woman in America, too fucking scared to take a chance. And they know that we scared to take a chance, so that's why they enslaving us. You can't be at home with your kids. You can't raise your kids. You at work all day. You got to do this. It's all these problems. The truth of the matter is, like the Africans tell me, the black man and black woman don't give a fuck about asking a question, because the black man and black woman think they got it figured out already. Getting their hair done, getting their toes done, getting their nails done, looking good. You know what I'm saying? Having every time I go outside in the summertime, it's our women out there with their ass hanging out. Now, granted, they be like, well, the white girls, but you ain't them. That be the point. It's like in black men saying, like, yo, we walk around with Speedos on, and then they get mad at us because they can see our sexual organs. And then black men get mad. Well, listen, they ain't us. So we can't. I don't live by the rules of just like, oh boy, that ran in the house. Like, you know, everybody was going in that house. So what? Well, I come from in Jersey City. Niggas be doing a lot of shit growing up. Don't mean I did it. That's my choice. That's called accountability. If people don't understand that, that means you to follow the leader type. And that's being blunt. You know what I'm saying? It's a lot of people. And that's why people, when y'all hear me talk, I'm just one of them niggas that's going to stand up and tell y'all the truth. I don't personally care about the feelings of black man or black woman, because black man and black woman got an opinion but don't want to read and educate themselves. Or they know, like, black man and black woman going to argue with the black man and the black woman who spent their life trying to figure out the truth. And black man and black woman know damn well they ain't spent more than 12 hours in their life even reading anything or trying to find out what happened. But yet, they'll argue with you over their God, right? And over there, what they think they know. Nothing has been proven. So that's why it's like, that's why they consider us little boys and girls. Because even in a dictionary, the word believe says in Latin books and law books, to believe is idiotic. Because to believe in by definition means to believe in something that's not there. But we live in a physical world. So they would say, well, everything around us has a physical property. You know what I'm saying? Right, everybody, and I say this because they don't care. When I go to the gas stations, the Africans love me. That's why I was able to stand at these gas stations for a year, because they could be honest with me. The African behind the counter has a right to tell the black man how he feels, especially the black man don't know. It's like, I know what I know. If it was up to my people, like my women and my men helping me find my history, I wouldn't know shit. But the fact that I went out on the edge, And other people like these doctors that live above me from India, who told me about what I was, to let me know what I was thinking was right about the Moors being from America and how they built the schools in India, or for certain Africans or certain other races I meet, even Europeans that I meet that's not evil, who would tell me like, yo, you write about this because we got these books, da-da-da-da. The question is, when do we stop? You know what I mean? Because black, you can't, Waka Flocka went on the shit and said, yo, we not black. How many times do you got to hear it? I'm not here to beat this in your head. I personally, and I'm going to keep it 100, I could care less what people want to call themselves or what you believe. You know what I mean? Because I ain't the person. I'm not here to try to tell you what to believe. Half the people, I could talk to them every day and educate you every day. And even if I give you the game and help you beat court cases, by next year, they still going to be living in that bullshit because people don't understand how to live in this world, how to balance both. You know what I'm saying? So I'm just being real. I spent that time doing the research in the courtroom, doing all of this shit. But the reality is, I know that black man and black woman don't give a fuck. Black man, what he care about is just going to the club, popping Molly, dominating each other. You know what I'm saying? Sports. And sports not bad because it keep a lot of black men, so-called black men, out of trouble. But like everything that doesn't matter to his progression in life. You know what I'm saying? Music is similar, but technically the sad part is that in ancient society, the musicians was higher regarded. So in America, they made a structure that made sure that the musician, aka the person that had, because the singer or the musician has the ability to get everybody emotionally on a chord in a room. A good singer can have everybody in their feelings. You know what I'm saying? Open a room up. So it's spiritual. You know what I mean? Or that's why, and I say this because like, y'all got to understand, I've had this conversation with thousands of people. Now, if I've had this conversation like consistently and helped probably like 150 as far as court cases and lifestyle, like really sat down with them way before I was doing these lives. And then to see them 3-4 years later, I see these niggas still living the same lifestyle. And I be thinking like, yo, it's not about, you don't have to change and turn into this old person in no temple. I ain't never said join, you had to do that or this old square, but I can tell that people get the information and then they're when they're around, real motherfuckers, they on their square, they on their shit. But when they go home and they go back to their world, they still living in that same bullshit and ignorance because that's the truth. You know what I mean? It's no way possible that I can know what I know and still live the same lifestyle that I was living before. Like when I first brought this information to my mother, she wasn't all the way against me. But one thing she told me was like, yo, to know all of this shit comes with a responsibility. But the responsibility comes with what? A lot of arguments with each other. You know what I'm saying? I got tired of going in rooms of people and having these conversations. You know what I mean? And that's being real because at the end of the day, black men and black women don't listen. You know what I mean? In our society, it's some stupid shit. Let me tell you, and I'm going to keep it 100 right now. Black woman won't listen to her little brother, right? But according to anything, who say your little brother can't be the prophet? See, it's that or if a big brother won't listen to his little sister because you're the oldest, or because you're the middle child and the baby child, who's to say that they're not the chosen one or the one that's going to bring it? That's an issue because everybody wants to be in first. Nobody in our community wants to accept anything. If we play ball, nobody wants to come in second. They get frustrated. We cry. We doing music. Niggas don't want to come in second and third place because we want to win. We want to dominate everything. You know what I'm saying? He said, justice paid big money to make music and perform back then. Well, yeah. It says, but I mean, y'all just got to understand, like, when we had these conversations, let's first be real about the conversation and let's be real and say our people don't give a fuck, right? Because if we can't deal with ourselves, we can't be real about it. I could play some shit, the August Alsina shit I played the other day. It was 85 people on my live. August won't talk about shit. Let's be real. What August do, him and Jada Pickett and Will and them, that's they fucking business. But our people so caught up on turmoil. If I brought more of that to the show, I'd be at 2 bands if I bring more bullshit to the table. Let's keep it a hundo. If I give y'all more shit that don't mean much or nothing but just entertainment, because black man and black woman have become zombies. All we give a fuck about is entertainment. We don't give a fuck about nothing real. And can't nobody argue this point with me. Because I know, I live in these communities and I go out here and I see how our people, black men from here, when I go back home to Jersey, everybody sleep. Niggas walking around. Nobody gives a fuck about finding out. Self-worth don't exist in the black community no more. Moms and them ain't whooping ass no more. Our parents whooped ass and held that last tradition. But our sorry asses, talking about 30 and up, our sorry asses got grown and thought that we knew better because we rebelled against our parents. I didn't like that they beat us, but our parents took this shit from what was being passed down. You know what I mean? Some of this shit, I get it, that you don't want to pass down. But some of the shit that I tell all adults today, and this is my problem with black adults. You still mad at your mama and daddy for some shit you did when you were 7? They were grown and you was a little kid, so your logic was fucked up in the first place. Now, some things our parents was wrong about, but you got a 34-year-old or a 33-year-old or a 28-year-old telling an 8-year-old to do something, and that 8-year-old mad when he's 30 years old about something. You are a kid, and your moral logic is fucking sideways. And half of us still got attitudes with our parents over shit that was like 7, 8, 9, 10. And if you can't look in the mirror and say, you know what? I was young, I was rude, and da-da-da. And then if you got kids, because it's this denial thing with black women today that be like, oh, I got kids. And, you know, I ain't gonna do this and I ain't gonna do that. And then wonder why when black men see him be like, yo, I don't wanna be bothered with y'all kids. But it be not because we trying to judge you or trying to be funny. It's just like, yo, I always say, a woman has no choice if she has to raise a child, so she has to. So respect, I respect that. But in a lot of ways, that's not the women of the last 15, 20 years. And I'm tired of everybody acting like the women of the last 20 years ain't nothing like the women before. It's not saying abuse doesn't exist, but there's so much abuse coming from the women and shit and the lack of trust and all this shit. Like, it's so much shit going on both sides of the table. That's why I always constantly deal with that. I really always tell people that I never really get too crazy about how people feel, because you have to remember, my conversations, nobody wanted to hear them anyway. I'm just, as I tell you, ask your brother if I'm bugging. Take my lives, take them to your brothers, take them to your man, if you smart enough to want to understand. Because half of the people, if you watch this show as a man or a woman and you don't take this back, and you if you can't take this information back, we talk about to your husband, your wife, your boyfriend, your girlfriend, it's your fault that you being oppressed. Because you shouldn't be with somebody who can't even, that you can't have these conversations with. You know what I mean? Yeah, B, truth hurts. People don't want to admit that they in denial before admitting it. Right. But if you got a motherfucker but if you have somebody in the family that want to do something better with their life, and what they going to call him, oh, bro, he a fuck nigga. He a sellout. You see this nigga, he think he better. No, I think I'm better than the bullshit that y'all choose to live in. No, I think I'm better than that foul shit that y'all choose to live by. No, I think I'm better because I want better for myself. It's a reflection of my water, of me. You know what I'm saying? If when people say, yo, he think he better than himself, they'll let me know what you think about yourself. You know what I'm saying? So if that's the case, if me loving myself make me think I'm better, then I'm cool with that shit. You know what I'm saying? But at the end of the day, at the same time, don't come around smiling. I ain't got nothing for you. You know what I'm saying? And that's the problem. Even when it comes down to black love. You know, the truth is that women want a sucker. They don't really want a man, they want a sucker. They want a man to come in and help them, but they don't want to hear the mouth and the complaining, and they don't want to hear the man's point of view, because society in the last 100 years has allowed the black woman to get away with murder and do a lot. You know what I'm saying? And then the black man being ignorant as hell, he frustrated. He already was doing shit, and he was doing shit early on, so his problem, his guilt. And the black man got guilt, the black woman got guilt. So now it's two fucked up sides of the table, and now the kids is absorbing all this shit. But at the end of the day, I'm watching a whole generation of people misparent, misguide, miseducate their children. You know what I'm saying? So people know, like, people got an idea that this ain't right, but people say, they be like, yo, Jers, and I don't mean no disrespect. People tell me all the time, yo, Jers, I ain't gonna tell my kids right now, they too young. So, okay, so let the school indoctrinate him. Because like the Holy Book says, show me a child when he's 5, I'll show you that man. So if you wait until your child is 18 when you think he's ready to get the information, the school system, the world has already indoctrinated him with white supremacy. And now you got to deal with the psychological power, the psychological abuse that he done went through. You know what I mean? And this is the reality. So when we sit here and we're going to deal with people and we're going to deal with the truth, everybody quicker to say, like, you know, I don't fuck with the African because the African man didn't come and save us. Did you ever ask why? Or did you care to research why? You ever think that we didn't come from the continent, so if people that didn't come from that continent ain't going to come and try to save the people? Now, we do most of the kings and queens who sold their people into slavery, who found out, they tried to go buy their slaves back, because slavery was always happening. You know, I buy your basically, you will work for me. You know, if you look at African culture, the slaves wasn't treated the same way. So you come in, and so you and your wife are my slaves. Y'all get married, but you know, you say, well, you'll sell your daughter to work for me as one of my maids. You know what I'm saying? But she also was treated a certain way. They also got paid for their daughter. They also got materials. But it doesn't mean that they was enslaved their whole life. You know what I'm saying? Like, the king might have needed certain things. Well, your daughter got to work for me for 10 years. Your son got to work for me for, you know what I mean? So it said materialistic things and money are not real. Money brainwashes. It's not even real. In the Constitution, it says the people should only take gold, silver, or copper. Those are money. Diamonds, that's money. But we running around here running up on each other, getting mad. Like, think about it. Materials. In America, you ain't a real man, a black, so-called black man, if you ain't got a dollar in your pocket, and a dollar has no material value. But let a man run up on you who got some gemstones, got 2,000 gemstones in his book bag, and he like, yeah, I got gemstones, but that nigga can't pay his rent. They'll laugh at that nigga, go get them a drug dealer. But that nigga with them gemstones in his book bag got more money than everybody. If he understand how to go get money for it, he become a jeweler. The problem is, we don't know. You know what I'm saying? Gold is the true currency. So that's why during the Great Depression, they took all the gold. They stole the shit. During the Great Depression, they said, give us all the gold, we're going to give you money. So they stole the money from the people. And the reason why, and like I tell y'all, don't get me wrong, I don't never hold no punches, because that's why I like doing live. I love the feedback I get live, but when I be in a room of 30 niggas, there's too many distractions. Everybody got opinions, and to be quite frank, everybody be having attitudes with the motherfuckers who know something. And quite frank, the niggas who know something, what about our attitudes? How about when we go in a room, we be looking around trying to, we don't have to have this conversation. It don't benefit us to try to help, and we get smacked down and tore down. So everybody who think that, oh, this shit come with, this shit is the way, the wave, oh, no. It's not the wave, because our people shun information. You know what I'm saying? Our people love religion but hate information. In the last couple weeks, all I've heard from black people who hit me on, not everybody, but a lot of people, is about, don't mix science and religion. Don't mix science and religion. And then I ask the question, because that's what the sheep say. But every pastor, E-man I've ever talked to one-on-one, I say, how can we not talk science when we talk religion, when the Bible, or how can we not talk history or science in religion, when they talk about science and history in the books? Every religious book attacked the Egyptians. Those are a people, right? And they all attack certain things. The Bible is talking about certain times. That's that time needs to be verified. And when was it cool? The Bible and the religious books are the only books on the planet that are not verified. Meaning that if you go to any intellectual school of thought, like what I mean, a college, and you got to prove something, you got to get, if you write a book or a book come out, you got to do the bibliography, you got to figure out the origins of the book, who wrote it, where they got their sources from, all of that, bibliography, right? And it's crazy because it's called Bibli, like Bible, right? Bibliography. But the Bible has no bibliography. It has no bibliography. And then even though people know that the Bible was mistranslated by Europeans, for the ones we got the King James Version, people still gonna argue. So that shit be stupid to me. People know, I don't like white people, but your ass still go to church. Oh, a black man is king, but your ass still worshiping the feet of some Arabs in the temple. Because that's true. The Nation of Islam followed the Arabs. Okay, what nobody say. When I was in Jersey, I got an argument in Jersey City. My pop stopped me because he was like, man, these niggas are crazy. Yeah, because Jersey don't want to admit that shit is embarrassing to know that them niggas from North killed Malcolm X. As much as we gonna look and be real about it, them Nook niggas killed Malcolm. And they ran down on him all for the profit. But at the end of the day, nobody wanna talk about that shit in New Jersey. That's that story. That's what that Netflix special. I knew that shit for like 14 years. Conversation I used to have with my father. He used to tell me, like, you know, you can't have that conversation up top. But the reality is, we so proud of a people. You feel me? We so proud, but we destroyed our fucking leaders. You know what I'm saying? Malcolm was what? Because he kept it a bando? Because he joined a secret society called the Nation of Islam. So that's what I say. People can question. I don't really spend a lot of time with the overall extras anymore because I got into so many arguments with niggas. And I tell y'all, I just tell niggas, figure it out. If you want to be black, be black. You know what I'm saying? But motherfuckers who be around me, that's why I keep to myself. They used to be like, bro, no disrespect. When the cops pull up on me, don't say that shit around me. And like I tell them, fuck you. When the cops come, I'm going to say that shit. You could choose to stay here and act like a black man. And when your ass go to jail, and when I keep it pushing, but you're not going to make me ignorant to your cause. So if you riding with me, if you can't deal with that shit, don't fuck with me. But the niggas who around me when I was in South Jersey and Willowboro, when they arrested all of us and they was like, yo, you know him? And they was like, yeah, we Moors too. All of us walked out. You think I'm lying? Look, ask my cousin Antoine Walker or Vincent or who else was with me? I think Jarrett was with me. They all live in Willowboro. This is fact though. And niggas had warrants for child support. You know what I'm saying? I self-law. I'm responsible for knowing the laws. But one thing I'm not here to do no more, I'm not pushing this Moore shit off on nobody. You know, freedom is for self. Information is for self. The idea of self-worth is for self. When I go, and I made this choice up the other day. Listen, when I go, we go back to our parents, our sisters, and siblings. This shit called argument. Well, fuck it. You live your life. But see if you prosper. And the sad part of the matter is the black family is so devolved that somebody can't come back to the family and bring information because you disrespecting their God. But as you heard Malcolm said in his fucking 60s, 70s, keep your God at home. I don't give a fuck what your God is. Your God don't benefit me or you. Your God ain't helping us when we getting shot down in the fucking street. Your God ain't doing nothing for us on a whole scale. Now, what your God do for you, I mean no disrespect. That's for you. That's your personal preference. But you can't make me respect your God like I can't make you respect mine. That's something that we have to clearly know by now, that this spiritual system, which is this religion, which isn't spirituality, has such a pull on the black family that the black mother more loyal to Jesus than she is her own fucking kids. The black father more loyal to the dollar and providing for his woman, because that's all that make a man today is his money, than it is for holding himself accountable in America. But they talk about the black man like he a dog, but the black man really is the only man on the planet that really give a fuck about people. You know what I'm saying? The only ones who really got that sense of compassion. So when some people say, man, you soft, I think that some of us in history, I don't think we could even understand that type of warfare at one time. You know what I'm saying? Because you have to understand, as people, we go somewhere and educate them for 70, 80 years, 100 years. And then when we die, they go and kill our kids off or enslave our kids. It's just a whole nother, it's a whole nother ball game. Like the enslavement in Europe, for example, in the Renaissance, it wasn't really about their skin color that made them mad that started this. It was the fact of the matter that the so-called Africans, which wasn't Africans, because they say it's the Moors, came into Europe. And then they was living in bars and they civilized them, cleaned up the black pad, built schools, built colleges, and the people admired and adored the Moors. That's why the women were just sleeping with a lot of the so-called black men. And the kings and queens thought that they were going to lose power. So it's that made them like go amongst each other all, because they was fighting at one time before the Moors got there. Those are barbaric wars. And then they came together like, look, man, we got to get them the fuck about our continent. And if we can conquer them, we can take everything. Because think about it. If you could run out the rulers of the universe and you can beat them when nobody else could, nobody else is going to challenge you. It was that easy. Only thing Europe had to do was beat us. And then the rest of the world was going to submit. And we don't realize that. Europe didn't have to fight the whole world. We did. We fought the whole world. So all they had to do was conquer the leaders. And then everybody else was going to follow suit. You know what I'm saying? Beat them with their own law. Constitution, law must read, facts. And they are beating us with our own law because they took us out of the human family and got us calling ourselves white and black. So even white people that consider themselves to be white, when they hear, people that think they're white, when they listen to me, even my information is even beneficial to what they, a European or another nationality. Because they need, because if they realize what I'm saying, then they will no longer call themselves white. And then they will claim a nationality and they will nationalize like Mark Zuckerberg did when he sold Facebook. He nationalized. You know what I'm saying? And a lot of people that has been in America for 100, 200 years, they're saying, oh, my family came from Germany. I'm a German. I'm not white, because they realize that a lot of famous people did this shit in the last 30 years because they realized it was coming. Just like in Germany. There was no such thing as a Jew. The Jew had no, there's no flag for a Jew. You know what I'm saying? Because the Jews and the Germans, they were both Germans because they lived in Germany. They didn't just move into Germany all of a sudden. They were Germans. But once the Jews stopped associating themselves as Germans, then they were out of the human family. And once they was out of the human family by law, that's why the Holocaust happened. You can kill a whole mass of people who don't know who they are because they're not humans by law. And that's why they tell you that the Holocaust and what's about to happen in America with these concentration camps the same. Don't listen to me. But damn sure don't hit my inbox when they start kicking in doors. And don't come looking for me and the niggas who've been telling y'all this real shit. I'm just real enough to say this shit to y'all. You know what I mean? Because deep down inside, y'all listen to all this shit and go back and live y'all life. Or I could build with motherfuckers forever. Or people, not just me, people like me build. And then 2-3 years later, it'd be the same person people disrespect. you know what I'm saying, over what they emotionally caught up over, even instead of going to look, you know what I'm saying? So that's why I tell people, for me, I don't be tripping. You know what I'm saying? And I understand, you know, forgiveness as the black man, like, you know, if you being calm and somebody cuss you out over you talking history, you got to kind of swallow that and you got to forgive them. But at the same time, it's like, that's their ignorance. You know what I'm saying? You don't wear that burden. But we'll get back to it, because it was a good conversation and question asked about what Keita was asking.
Earth, the Moor Science Temple, had understanding about the Moorish legacy, was talking to some brothers who worked with him, and laid it out. Sounded, I imagine, probably a lot like I sound in terms of sharing historical information and talking about context and everything else. And when he finished, he said that he sat down to eat. Good look, and this B. Japanese man,
we gonna talk
got
to
up
B.
from.
For y'all know, me and B grew up together in Jersey City, like one of my a real friend that I can say that we grew up together that always been itself. So B was letting y'all know, if y'all got questions, we come off this way, but y'all can clearly hit us in the inbox and talk to us. We not too big to talk to y'all about it, or even care if you don't take it and say you're more. Just get the information. It's for you. It's for your kids, you know? We never said that you had to do anything.
His table, which was a little further down, came over, bowed. He said, now we
can. Yeah, me and B was big ballers. So if you know, we was pulling up the courts and shutting courts down, like big ballers for real. Basketball players. Some of the best.
Can talk. Amnesiatic, right? Subjugated or oppressed. This idea of people not knowing, which results in many people who do not, excuse me, who do know, not wanting to associate with us. Because as they say, we don't know how to act. And it's like, look, I don't know what I can trust you with in terms of talking with you. Or I don't know what you're going to do, because you may have no honor. Because you don't know who you are. This is telling us even about those connections, right? Brazilian Muslims that people often don't make reference to, which were part of these religious groups that brought different people of African ancestry together. So people practicing traditional, if you will, African spiritual systems. And then you had people who were practicing an African interpretation of Islam that goes back to the Marabouts. And in fact, there are names, Maravitinas, Marabios, which are Native American surnames. How do you get a Native American surname, Marabios and Maravitinas? These are all derivations of Marabout. Even Moabite, which was a term used also for the people in the 11th and 12th century, who were in where? Al-Andalus. So you have the Spanish Catholics referring to these people as Moabita, who are also known as the Almoravides. Medieval historians have sometimes referred to the Dark Ages as cold, hard, and brutish. And that's referring to when Europe fell into a period of kind of cultural and social decay following the collapse of the Roman Empire, which was a great empire. The Moors, starting in the late 7th, early 8th century of the Common Era, have brought in the best knowledge from the ancient world, things that had existed in ancient Kemet or Egypt. In fact, George James talks about the Moors as the custodians of Egyptian culture and history. And George G.M. James doesn't get enough, I think, credit for his contribution in Stolen Legacy. Got his doctorate, as I understand, from Columbia University. So this was no slouch. But James said the Moors were the custodians of ancient Egyptian culture. The Moors, the Muslim world interacting, now has connections to China, to India, Nile Valley, Western Sudanic empires of Mali, Ghana, and Songhai, as well as Persia and throughout. And I would even venture to say connections and trade with the Americas. But all that ancient knowledge that Africans and Asians, and even the knowledge that the Greeks had possessed, was something that the Moors, meaning the African or African and Asian Muslim population, had brought together and are spreading throughout Europe, pulling Europe out of its dark ages, setting up institutions of higher learning. Clearly, such folk are going to look very attractive, certainly to the rank and file. The only people who would see those individuals as not being attractive would be those in positions of power. Now you're talking about the conflict with the church, right? The Roman Catholic Church, who would see that, wait a minute, we have to do all we can to try to demonize or negate these people because we're losing our parishioners. One of my mentors, Dr. Asante, who actually brought this out, I think in his book, Kemet, Afrocentricity and Knowledge. But he's the one that said that the conquistadors argued that it was okay to enslave the Indians because they didn't have nationality.
That's deep. Think about that. The Spanish conqueror said that it was okay to enslave the Indian because he did not have a nationality. So remember when I told y'all just the other day that on the old ancient maps I found, I'm going to find it. I think it was the Duke of Tears who was playing it, or Dan Calloway. It was showing that the 13 colonies was not considered a part of Mexico, which is America, right? Or Mexum. Why would the Indians live on the outskirts where we know that the indigenous population of what we call Africans today always kept the mixed breeds of the foreigners on the outskirts in case of war, they could push them back to the water or back to home. You know what I'm saying? So when you hear that, it makes you think.
It's okay to enslave them because they didn't have nationality. In their minds, they had so objectified these indigenous peoples. They had reclassified them as, like I said, negros, or even if they use the term indios or Indians. Some of them, if they made treaties with different groups, then again, a treaty implies I recognize that you have nationhood. But if someone is adhering to the term that I'm using to deny your existence as a person, then you are telling me you're not a person under the law, right? You just told me you're a Negro, you're black. Terms that existed in US law and in much of European law, and specifically the term black for those in British law, for someone who didn't have personhood. Right? Or you'd have to qualify it, black person. But if you said blacks, it was understood that a person who you defined as black or Negroes can't be citizens. Because Negroes under the law were never meant to be citizens. Negroes are property. And when people tried to make blacks or Negroes into citizens, it caused a constitutional rift.
By law.
Right? Now, this in part relates to the fact that there was a treaty that existed between the U.S. and the Moorish Empire. But it also relates to those who were simply following the law and saying, if you're calling yourself colored.
Let me say this, because B, what got me here was I was studying law, right? And you can't help but to constantly run into it. When I looked up free white persons, it says, does not mean European race. Anybody with Moorish blood. If you got any concept of what Moor is, then you start to understand real quick that these people in America has been kept ignorant and docile to this black power movement, to these certain movements. But none of these movements gave us freedom. But once these leaders so-called started thinking for themselves, they always got assassinated. You know what I mean? So that's what a lot of people don't realize. A lot of these assassinated leaders were people who actually were dealing with the corporations or had the knowledge they got it from working within without studying for themselves. You know what I mean?
Negro. Black. This country requires that for you to be a citizen, you have to be free and a national. So even though this group is now called white, I can ask you, what's your name? O'Reilly. Oh, you're an Irish national. What's your name? Heimbach. Oh, you're a German, and so forth. If you couldn't affirm your nationhood, you were not a protected national. Democratic republics.
Remember what they said, what was Malcolm about to do? He was about to get black people to nationalize, to claim a nation, right? So when we hear what he's saying, is to understand everything he's saying it in such a great way to understand, because people don't want to hear, or people can't seem to understand when a lot of us are break down to you that the term Negro, blacks, colors, Ethiopians, Mexicans is the Christian color codes of 1724. Right? And you can look this up. The Christian color codes are 1724. Write this down. Because I'm not arguing with people. Like, and not saying nobody arguing, but you'll have these arguments. And I'm showing y'all how to talk, how to, y'all can take this and show people. Because sometimes people have to see. We visual people. You know what I mean? But everything that he's breaking down to everybody is just basically law. Understanding that this 14th Amendment, and I told you that all of the amendments are like stabbing the Constitution. You know what I mean? So you can't be black, you can't be Negro, you can't be colored, you can't be anything. And as he said with the white people that come here, when I said that whenever I see police officers, I'm able to recognize by looking at them that a lot of them aren't European. So when I start talking this shit, just like he said it, I say, well, sir, well, let me ask you a question. I'm like, what's your nationality? And if they tell me they're German or whatever, then they know nationality. So then that's when I come at them. So at the end of the day, I really feel disrespected. And then they start apologizing because they do have the right to assume that we're ignorant. But at the end of the day, this is what he means. And even a white person in America, a so-called white man and woman in America is just as fucked up as a so-called black person, because either one of them can be assassinated and killed because there is no such white people or black people. They're statuses. You know what I'm saying? But if a person considers themselves white, then they can be killed. That's why they get killed by police officers, too. But it's just showing, for example, you know what I mean? And anytime, like in Raleigh or in Cary right next door a couple years ago, he was Indian. He was from India, right? And he had a nationality. And that cop got like 20 years.
Which is what the country was and presumably still is. During the days of slavery, you would have had citizens.
July, what up?
Aliens and slaves. Aliens can become citizens if they're naturalized. Slaves were legally defined as property. So if you're legally defined as a Negro can't have the...
That's how they work. But yeah, so I just wanted to... Let me get to this next thing. Let's get to it. How y'all feeling? How y'all feeling? I want some feedback. How y'all feeling? B, I appreciate your feedback and your open dialogue. I appreciate everybody who come up here and tag the board up for interaction so that when other people come and watch it or people that come back from work and then they change it, you know what I mean? I mean, they can respond and they can see how y'all felt or what's understood amongst the room and not so much just in one area. But yeah, I think that covers about all of it. In reality... This is about to go off. In reality,
given a granted privilege. So when the...
Let's get it. We're going to finish this.
Also, the late, great John Hope Franklin talked about quasi-free Negroes. Quasi-free meant, yeah, you weren't enslaved. You weren't on a plantation. But your rights were essentially non-existent. You were given privileges.
Let me explain. And that's exactly what black people have. In North Carolina, they say, when I go to court and represent myself, they say that driving is a privilege. And I say, well, for the record, you know, traveling is inalienable, meaning that it cannot be taken from you, cannot be restricted. But the term driving is commercial. And a person, a white or black person, or so-called these people, they are awarded privileges. So that's why if you don't have a national, you're supposed to have a driver's license. Because they're going to allow their cattle and their slaves to drive with their permission. As long as you, yeah, go ahead. My slave can own a car as long as he bring it and register it to me and pay me for driving. That's it. Point blank, period. You know what I'm saying? BH.